Welcome to this seminar on dementia research, with particular emphasis at looking at where the gaps and future directions are. Everyone knows someone with dementia, and therefore dementia is the subject of discourse in every house in the land, I imagine, across every meal table. And public awareness of dementia has grown, as has been the intention of the government, has grown greatly over 5 years, because 5 years ago, 5, 10, 15 years ago, I certainly couldn't have made a statement like that in public. So everybody has kind of clocked dementia, it's important that we understand as much as we can about causes and the course of it. So welcome. My name is Tom Denning, and I'm Professor of Dementia Research at Nottingham University. And on my right is my co-chair, Sally Greengross.
Oh, hello, good afternoon, everyone. I'm really delighted, especially with you, Tom, to be co-chairing this very important seminar. I think it's really good news that the government, in the name of the Prime Minister, are so committed to dementia research and action. And the research group that the department has set up, and which I'm very happy to be a member of, has been looking at where we're going. And we do get this encouraging sign now from the government that they are behind this, put in some money for research and an action plan, a national plan. And that's probably the most encouraging news we've had for a long time about one of the most challenging areas in life that we all face now. So I'm really privileged to jointly chair this with you.
Okay. We have a panel of speakers who will be arriving by degrees, I think. And then there's also the opportunity for a panel discussion, so I hope that will be lively, and I hope we'll manage to keep to time in order to do that. Now it gives me great pleasure to welcome James Orr, who's from, if I get this right, the
Mortality Research Steering Committee.
Okay, to offer a few words and a further welcome, James.
It's a real pleasure for me to welcome you all on behalf of the actual profession. As Tom was saying, I am the chair of the Mortality Research Steering Committee, which is a multidisciplinary group that, as the actuaries, we have established and have a great pleasure in engaging with a wider stakeholder group on issues around demography, epidemiology, aspects of care, particularly in the old and the old. And what we've been looking to do with this event and three others is to just think about what are the major challenges that the future is holding for us. Can we understand the current state of understanding of that issue? And of course, dementia is the topic tonight. And what are the key questions that we should be looking at when we're thinking about what research either we want to engage with or fund, or also research that we need to keep abreast of? So we are very much, as the actuaries, looking forward to learning from this more diverse kind of group of experts and interested parties to see what the key themes are, the current research that's coming through on dementia. So I very much look forward to not just the presentations from our esteemed speakers and our esteemed co-chairs as well, contributions, but also what questions you as in the audience pose, because that will give us an understanding of what those key questions are, which will then feed into our consideration of our own research strategy, whether under the Mortality Research Steering Committee or more generally for the profession itself. So very grateful to not just the actuaries who are here today, but also the wider group that's represented in the hall. So thank you very much, and I look forward to both the speeches and the contributions from the audience.
Thank you very much. So our first speaker, and once I've introduced you, we will gracefully exit from this magnificent table. Our first speaker is Professor Claire Goodman, who's the Professor of Healthcare Research at University of Hertfordshire. We've reversed the order of the speakers because, unfortunately, Professor Clive Bower's not here yet. Hopefully he's here. He will be here. If he's not, then we'll simply bring the discussion forward and have a bit longer. So would you welcome Claire Goodman?
very much. And it's a great pleasure to be here, and slightly daunting in terms of the, well, partly the venue and partly the audience as well. But there, so I hope that there'll be something for everyone here and not nothing for no one. I'm going to put the technology away. This is the presentation, and I'm deliberately going to spend probably more than you would have expected time on talking about care homes. And that's because if I don't, talking about end-of-life care for people with dementia is a little bit like talking about post-Second World War foreign policy and not mentioning Russia. So you have to understand the context. And if you take nothing else from this talk, I feel that that's one of the most important messages. But I will talk about end-of-life care and dementia, what we know, what the best evidence is, some of the challenges that exist around working across systems of care, and then move on to some recommendations, which the panel, I think, will then be able to progress with. So this slide is basically making a key point about where we provide long-term care for older people. And the majority of long-term care for older people is for people who have some degree of dementia. So hospital beds in England are just under 160,000 and falling. And we have just under 460,000 care home beds provisioned. So basically the message there is we have shifted our care of our oldest old into the independent provider sector, which is a mixed economy of care. And of that provision, 6 out of 10 places are in the provision is where there is no on-site clinical support. So there are no, they're not nursing homes. That is changing, but that's a very important message to understand when you're trying to think about how we provide end-of-life care. And then the other thing, this is becoming a bit dated, and Martin will pick this up, is also to think about, well, what do these care homes look like? And they still, the majority, if you look at the right-hand side, that's the pale colour represents care homes that are residential, offering personal care and support. That's the majority of them. And the majority of them are 10 beds or less. So we've got a very heterogeneous sector. It's changing. There are, I think we're about to have the crossover to equal numbers of nursing and residential care, and we are certainly seeing much bigger providers taking, incorporating the smaller care homes into their provision. But nevertheless, that is the kind of picture that we're dealing with. And we have a very ambivalent relationship with our care home providers as a society and as individuals. Can I just ask how many in this audience have thought about the kind of care home they'd like to go to? Oh, okay, that's a much better response than usual. All right. And this is from The Independent about a month and a half ago, which was just talking about the level of debt of our major providers, and I know Martin's going to pick up with this, and where their head office is located, whether it's in this country or whether it's in the Cayman Islands or Jersey and Guernsey. So the kind of things that raise concern in the collective imagination and which gets translated into how we think about these places that provide care for the oldest old. So, just to summarise some of those points, we have a very mixed economy of provision. 50% of people are still being admitted from hospital to care homes. That isn't in line with policy, but that is still what is happening. There is an overlap between those people who are admitted for residential care or care where there's no nursing provision and those that receive nursing provision. The majority are female and 85 plus. And the market value is 22 billion, of which 16 billion is state funded. So that's the sort of. And the reason why I have this attractive picture here, which I'm assuming is somewhere in Scotland, is because people increasingly are talking, borrowing and mangling Susan Sontag's idea of kingdoms of the sick and saying care homes are a bit like islands of the old. They're sort of linked to us, but separate. They're not part of our communities, they're not part of our healthcare, and yet we rely on them. Next slide. So if you are admitted to a care home, the kind of situation that is that that's a marker that your home care is no longer able to support you. The rehabilitation and acute services probably have come to the end of what they can offer. And yet you have ongoing needs for proactive and active support, and you are in the last years of life. So that's a sort of, which presents a particular mix of needs, but you're not entering a care home to die. Now, this is just some findings from a study that we did that was looking at how the NHS works with care homes. So care homes rely on primary health care for access to all their medical support and for referral to specialist and community services. So the NHS has this very ambivalent relationship. It's the solution. It's where all our long-term care has been moved to. But it's also the problem, because there's a perception, which evidence has varying validity, is that it creates excessive demand and inappropriate demand on the NHS. These care homes are a hub for NHS services. A national survey that we've just published, we found that there were as many as 23 separate NHS services going into care homes. So that's quite a lot of different services going in for different people. But actually, when you looked at the most frequent services, then it narrowed very quickly down to just 2, 3, or 4, which were GPs and community nurses. And then when you look about how the NHS engages with care homes, again, it's very erratic. So this is just a list of different extra financial incentives that are used to try and sustain care homes and enable them to provide good health care. So intermediate care, end-of-life care, support teams, extra payments to GPs, that's personal medical services, local enhanced services, deputising community geriatricians, GP and community geriatrician collaborations, and then GP and community nursing support, where they run extra services within the care. So a whole range of ways of trying to hold what is quite a complex picture of care. So that's the care homes. Now I'm coming on to dementia, and then I'll finish with dying. So it's a good 3 topics. And again, this is drawing a little bit from Susan Sontag and Neil Small's, Catherine Froggatt and Myrna Downs' book, where they just reflect on where we have the collective anxiety. So in the early modern society, it was TB. In our modern society, it's been cancer. And now, very much what is referred to as the master illness, the illness that provokes anxiety and the unease, is dementia. And I think it does. It provokes extra anxieties. I think everybody's very clear that's one disease they don't want to have. And yet, you know, people are living with cancer and are able to live with that and anticipate it. I was always very struck by Graham Stokes from Bupa, who once at a lecture said, "I do not have the arrogance to assume I will not get dementia." And I think we always think we're not going to be one of the 1 in 3 for when you're in post-mid-80s. But anyway, so that's just to accept that what we are dealing with is something that also provokes anxiety, never mind the complexity of the issues that having dementia can create at the end of life. So end-of-life care, palliative care, specialist care is aiming to ensure an individual's dignity, ensure that what they want is actually known, particularly if they no longer have the capacity to communicate their priorities. It's about effective management of the kind of symptoms that can occur at the end of life, like breathlessness and pain management. Again, complicated if somebody with dementia can't communicate in the sort of usual ways that we use. And avoid inappropriate admissions when actually it's unhelpfully prolonging treatment and not actually providing any kind of recovery or palliation. And artificial feeding, which is a big issue in America, and there's an issue here. And also about aiming to make sure that family members and care home staff understand what can be expected at the end of life. So these are the kind of goals that we're looking at when we're thinking about end-of-life care for people with dementia. So 30 to 75% of care homes residents have some form of dementia, and that is incredibly elastic. So there are some people, and I think Carol Brain has made this observation, where the dementia is not actually a problem because they're in a place that is able to manage and cater and respond appropriately to the person with dementia. So therefore, it's insignificant, but obviously there is a huge range. And this is an underestimate. This is from a Dementia UK report. And they have multiple morbidities associated with age. 30% have advanced dementia, and the median life expectancy in a care home, and again, this is old data now, is 2 to 3 years if you go into a care home that doesn't have on-site nursing, and 1 to 2 years if you go into a nursing home. And what I find interesting is that the care home providers know this and do their business plans on this, but the healthcare service has been very slow to understand this. But you're not dying. You haven't gone there to die, but you have a limited life expectancy. So there are lots of different ways that people die. And this is work that comes from originally work that was done analysing minimum data sets from America, which is extensively reported by other authors and again needs to be revisited. So the top one is saying if you are dying with cancer, you will have a short, your function maintains reasonably stable. You're able to do most things and then you have a very rapid decline that goes to death and is very relatively predictable for an actuarial audience. This one is reasonably predictable and a lot of our palliative care models are predicated on the assumption that you can recognise when somebody is dying and that you can mobilise your services and provide support appropriately. The second one is when people have a life-limiting disease like heart failure or chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and the pathway to end of life is one where you have acute exacerbations, you recover, but you don't recover quite so well until then you die. So there is a sort of, you move into end stage. And then based on the analysis of retrospective data, they say then you have people who are just old, and obviously, in terms of prognostication, age is the best is one of the few that we have when you're talking about dementia is accurate. You just, as you get older, you become progressively more frail on this, I think, unhelpful title, prolonged dwindling, which is not really life-affirming, I feel. But anyway, there are days when I feel like I'm dwindling, so there we are. So, and this sort of shapes a lot of our understanding. So if we're looking at this bottom trajectory, what does that look like in a care home? You know, how does one make sure that we address all the things that people need in terms of comfort, respect for choice, making sure that family are involved, you know, making sure they're not in pain? When we have this sort of long trajectory, and you remember that I emphasized that life expectancy, I gave you a median. And the reason I gave you a median was because there is a huge range. There are people who've been in care homes for 8 years, and there are people who only live for 4 months. But the median life expectancy for somebody in residential care is was 25 months, but I think it has got shorter. Okay, so this is from a study that we did where we tracked 133 people with dementia across 6 care homes to look to see what happened to them, what services they used. And I'm just going to give you this as an example of what a dwindling trajectory could look like and how complex it is when you're trying to deliver services. Okay, so this was a woman who had been in a care home for 4 years. She had an advanced care plan, so she'd put in place what she wanted. She definitely wanted to die in the care home. She didn't want to have an unnecessary hospitalization. She didn't want to have aggressive interventions. That was clear, and her daughter knew that as well. But in the 4 years she'd been there, she had been prone to recurrent infections, which the care homes were used to dealing with. She'd been there 4 years. This was part of her story. She died in hospital. And these are this, she was basically spent the last 2 weeks of her life in hospital. What happened 26 days before was that she had a chest infection that had not been responding to antibiotics, and they, for some reason, the care home decided to refer her to A&E. She was discharged the same day, but there was no letter given, no guidance. The GP then followed up just 2 days later, decided to continue the antibiotics, do a repeat chest x-ray, and said to the care home staff, hospitalization will be necessary if not responding to antibiotics. Radiology department receives the referral. District nurse comes in because this lady also has a pressure sore and recognizes this woman is not well and needs pressure relieving aid and puts in orders some equipment and a mattress. She comes in again and redresses the heel. 999, the woman now has breathing difficulties, so they phone for the ambulance and she goes into hospital. Care home telephones the hospital to find out what's happened because nobody's told the care home and told it's a suspected pneumonia. They telephone again 2 days later and told that the resident is chesty, not mobilising, and three people are needed to get out of bed and they're waiting to see a GP and a physiotherapist. Telephone call now from the hospital saying, from the physiotherapist wanting to know, well, how mobile was this woman before she came in to establish some kind of baseline? Doesn't know whether this person has deteriorated or this is what normal looks like. Telephone call again from the care home and they're told, resident's still chesty, not mobilising or eating very much, but we'll inform you of any change and call when better and ready for discharge. Final entry in care home notes is that she died and the relatives had called to arrange collection of her possessions and no further detail. I'm sorry, I missed this bit here. But what we also see in the care notes at the end is that the care home clearly were documenting her dwindling and her fairly rapid deterioration. But with all these different people involved, it wasn't clear who was coordinating this and leading this. And an advanced care plan without that wasn't going to stop this woman going into hospital. And we looked at different trajectories to end of life and came up with what we see as the three key issues that need to be considered when thinking about end-of-life care for people with dementia in long-term care. So the challenges are basically about holding and managing uncertainty. And the first is pathway uncertainty. This woman had had a history of antibiotic use, recurrent infections. It wasn't unusual. So when do you decide this actually is no longer intervention and what she needs is a different kind of care? The signs were all there, but they were quite difficult to pick up. And there were different messages coming from different sources. Defining quality of life was different for the care home to the medical services that were involved. And actually, some of these care homes had end-of-life care tools, but they didn't quite work for this particular person in trying to interpret what was happening and for other people. Service uncertainty, the hospital hang on to this woman. Why did they do that? When we've done the interviews, it's because they're not confident the care home can actually manage this person. And the hospital hadn't recognised that she was dying. So there's something about capacity and resources that also need to be addressed when you're thinking about providing end-of-life care for people with dementia. And then this one, which is providing care across systems, which is how do you hold it all together? And what we have is relational uncertainty. Who do I relate to? Who am I responsible to? That woman is paying £800 a week. I'm not sure I should be going in and making the decisions. That should be somebody else. Those kind of narratives. Who am I accountable to? The regulator, care home staff are worried about coroners saying you didn't refer, residents, family members saying you should have sent her to hospital. And the involvement of the GP, secondary care, family, care home staff and resident. How do all these people work together? So what we need are interventions that can address all three. So what do we know? What does the research tell us? Well, the good news is, sorry, I feel a bit like I'm Harry Potter here. No, don't do that one. is that we have got huge progress in addressing over-treatment, and there are people here in this audience who know far more about this than me and are leading some very significant pieces of work. There is an increased awareness in care homes, and there's been a massive and impressive move with various end-of-life care frameworks to actually help and support how we identify people on that very difficult trajectory of when are they living, are they dying, have they actually made that transition or not. And we also see that there is that where the studies that show if you put in facilitated training and support into care homes, it definitely improves resident outcomes and reduces inappropriate use of A&E and secondary care. So those are the good news stories. There is progress. But when we look at the evidence, we still have the evidence is dominated by America. And that is problematic because they are also organized with Medicare. So they ask questions like on prognostication from a 6-month perspective, because 6 months is the turning point that you are eligible for hospice payments. So that drives a lot of their questions, unsurprisingly. And that's a problem. End-of-life care mimics, if you remember that earlier slide, the same ad hoc provision of everything else into care homes from a healthcare perspective. So you can be in a care home down this road that is using excellent end-of-life care and 2 miles away that has no frameworks in place, hasn't negotiated the relationship with the GP, and actually feels a little bit at sea about how to support people. We still don't have very dementia-specific interventions which actually recognise that people with dementia need different kind of interventions. What we have are some very good interventions that have been adapted from cancer care. And still, the focus is on dying from dementia, so looking at people with advanced dementia, whereas in fact, the majority of people will die with it as a complicating factor, but not the reason that they actually reach for their death. So, recommendations. It depends on your discipline, and I think that's a very clear message when you look at the research. So all these recommendations are good. There are some I would prefer everybody to invest their money in than others, but we can leave that for the panel. Clearly, we need to do implementation studies of promising interventions and policies that are making a difference. We're not there. We're still sitting on a lot of descriptive research. From our work on Everdem End of Life, and we did do an intervention, and I would have liked to have given you all the nice outcomes, but there isn't time. We need interventions that actually have at their core that it's uncertain, and uncertain at those 3 levels, so that we find ways that people know they're holding uncertainty, because then that increases, it manages the anxiety, and it means that you get more informed decision-making. And exploits the capacity and assets in the system, because we have seen across this country excellent care and poor care within this exactly the same system. So there's something that needs to be tapped into there. There is a need to incentivize. We know that that works, that if you pay people to do things, if you provide them with extra incentives, you do tend to get better outcomes, particularly in how primary healthcare works. But at the moment, we're not terribly good at monitoring or auditing or ensuring that it follows through. And we need to invest in dissemination and knowledge transfer, because there is a lot of this knowledge is held by quite small groups, and it needs to cross lots of different organisational and disciplinary boundaries. And controversially, we need a public health of dying, because we need to contextualise what we're talking about here in a wider debate about dying. Because just because you've got dementia doesn't mean that you'll have talked about these things earlier and nobody else has talked about it. So there's something about there needs to be a massive change. So I'm just going to finish with this paraphrase of Susan Mitchell's comment, where she says, people with dementia and their families are perhaps the most important stakeholders in this research. And this is her reviewing decades of work with advanced dementia. Ultimately, their advocacy and enfranchisement must play the greatest role in driving advanced dementia research forward through the next decade. And I would agree with her. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Gives me great pleasure to welcome our next speaker, who's Professor Clive Ballard, who's Professor of Old Age Psychiatry at King's College London, the Institute of Psychiatry, and also Director of Research for the Alzheimer's Society.
Thank you. Okay, yeah. What I'm going to hopefully do is a few things. I'm going to just say a few introductory comments to try and get the terminology around dementia. Most of you probably know it, but it's very easy to misunderstand some of it. And then I'm going to talk about 3 things. Opportunities for primary prevention of dementia in sort of healthy midlife and old age, treatment of conditions that could lead to dementia as secondary prevention, and then the development of disease-modifying medications which could potentially delay the onset of dementia in people with some kind of established disease. I think firstly, terminology. I mean, dementia itself isn't a disease, it's an umbrella term that covers a range of diseases that affect the brain. So diseases that cause progressive deterioration of the neurons, nerve cells in the brain, or vascular damage to the brain. So it's not a single condition, it's a range of different disease processes that lead to progressive decline. In some ways, the confusion is that actually the point at which those diseases are actually called dementia, whichever they are, is a very arbitrary decision. because it's based on the point at which the individual that's affected with a condition is significantly affected in their daily function. So that's actually an arbitrary decision to many degree, in you know, many ways. It's people tip over the edge. The disease has been going on in the brain for a long time before that. It's the point at which it significantly impacts on everyday life that it is called dementia. And I think it's also very important that those disease processes have, for most people, been going on in the brain for a long, long time before it actually tips to that particular point. And I think we've got one of the recent updates in the terminology is people developing criteria for what they've called early Alzheimer's disease. And this is people who have the disease process going on in their brains but don't have the full clinical syndrome of dementia. And that would usually be reflected by sort of relatively early memory problems combined with some changes on brain scans or looking at proteins in spinal fluid that would actually suggest that the process is there and going on in that individual. So I guess that just... Sorry for saying things that people probably already know, but it's just to give a little bit of a framework to some of the terminology. I haven't quite got the wizardry skills of waving, so I'll try next slide, please, and see how that works. Thank you. So when we start talking about prevention, I mean, if any of you admit to reading the Daily Mail, which I'm sure you don't, you know, every week there's some kind of new story about some new super berry that protects dementia. You know, is it curry? Is it red wine? Whilst personally, I choose to believe that it's curry with a glass of red wine, you know, what really is the evidence to actually support that? What does the evidence actually say? Next slide, please. Well, one of the sort of public myths is that the brain is like a muscle and that the more you exercise it, you know, the better it'll be and the less likely that you are to develop cognitive impairment or dementia. So is that actually true? Well, there is a fair few studies looking at this. The best work is Sherry Willis's study in the US. She did an enormous trial with over 2,000 people called the ACTIVE trial, where they got one of four types of brain training or a control treatment, and they were followed up in total for 5 years. The benefits were very small, but they were statistically significant, and across a large number of people, you know, that could be very, very impactful. The important thing is the kind of things she did wasn't just getting people to practice things, it was actually teaching them strategies. So it was teaching them mnemonic strategies to memorize things better, it was teaching them improved problem-solving skills. And it was actually only the arm that looked at the problem-solving skills which actually led to generalized benefits. Otherwise, if you train people techniques for memory, their memory will be slightly better, but nothing else will be better. It was only teaching problem-solving techniques that seemed to generalize across other aspects of thinking and function. So that approach did seem to work. It was a very, very small effect size. It was quite an intense intervention, but it did give quite long-lasting, if modest, benefits to the individuals. Next slide, please. I guess what that leads on to is the idea of, well, okay, that's teaching strategies, but what about the things that most people actually do, you know, crosswords, Sudoku, brain training games, where you're not learning strategies, you're just practicing things. And if you read, there's nobody here who works for Nintendo, is there? Because otherwise I'm probably about to get sued. But if you look at the Nintendo DS games, if you look at the inset and you read it, you know, it would make you think you play that game a handful of times, there's no chance you'd ever develop a cognitive impairment or any kind of dementia whatsoever. But then you actually realize that their entire evidence was based on one study of 30-odd people without a control treatment. And that was kind of what they were basing their claims on. So we thought it might be a good idea to do a slightly bigger study. So we did the Alzheimer's Society, together with the MRC in Cambridge, together with the BBC, did quite a large randomized controlled trial of over 10,000 people that did online brain training games or a control treatment using internet search tasks. And the games were designed to be as close to Nintendo DS as they could be without getting into legal kind of deep water. And the basic gist of it was that, we're now looking at longer-term outcome data. This was over 6 weeks. But people practicing games get better at doing those games. So they improve about 25% on each of the games they're actually playing almost every day. Next slide, please. But when you actually look at things that are slightly independent of the games, even things that are using the same aspects of thinking as the games are using, there's no generalization at all, and there's no benefit whatsoever. So I think what this is suggesting overall is, yes, learning strategies might be a little bit helpful, but actually just the use it or lose it philosophy probably isn't true, that just practicing different aspects of thinking or playing games or doing crosswords or Sudoku, it might be fun, but it's probably not going to stop you getting dementia. Next slide, please. So if the answer isn't playing Nintendo DS, you know, what could actually be, what could be helpful, what could be doing it? Well, we set up the Alzheimer's Society, together with the BBC, set up an expert group that involved, you know, sort of Carol Brain, one of the statisticians from the Cochrane Review, a number of people, to actually look at the literature, to consider over 70 review papers and original data papers of the large epidemiological studies, to summarise those and then to make recommendations based on this data. And I think several of these factors do come out very, very strongly. So, for example, obesity in midlife, a lot of trials over a lot of people, and there's probably at least a 20% increase in risk of Alzheimer's disease in people who are clinically obese. Some studies suggest it could be as much as twofold or even slightly higher. Probably the most consistent is for physical exercise and activity. Again, all of the studies show some kind of benefit. The dose of exercise varies a little bit between studies. How they define it varies. But there's a lot of people, 13 epidemiological studies, more than 150,000 people, and pretty consistent evidence of a reduced risk. Smoking, as you would expect, significantly increases risk. So stopping smoking, again, would be useful. Alcohol use is a difficult one because although alcohol, people with moderate alcohol intake were at reduced risk statistically, I think the problem with interpreting the alcohol story is that the control group, the comparison group, is actually very, very difficult. It's not a typical group. It might include people from different cultural or religious backgrounds. It might include people who can't drink alcohol because of medical reasons or other reasons. So it's a difficult group to understand. So I think my own personal interpretation of that, whilst I'd, you know, love to believe that a regular glass of beer or wine was helpful, is that it's probably an artifact of the comparison group rather than a real effect. But some of my colleagues might disagree with that. I think when you're looking at these figures, the other thing that you kind of have to bear in mind is these aren't controlled trials, they're following people up over time. And people tend to group together in the sense that, you know, people who do one healthy thing are likely to do another healthy thing. You've probably not got that many people who, you know, exercise excessively and then lie on the sofa eating burgers. So it's kind of quite often difficult to tease out the power of each individual factor because you've probably got a sort of cluster of things working together. So the risk, the potential benefit for any one of these factors is probably a fair bit smaller than those studies suggest because you've got that added kind of impact of all the other things that cluster with them. Next slide, please. I think the other reason that exercise stands out, though, is that it is supported by some randomized controlled trial evidence. There are three studies in people with mild cognitive impairment that are small studies but all show benefit compared to a placebo treatment. There's also this very impressive study a couple of years ago in healthy older adults where they were randomized to, you know, either a more intense exercise program or what they usually do. Their cognitive function improved, but also, interestingly, on brain scanning, the hippocampus, the part of the brain that deals with memory, actually got significantly bigger as well by a couple of percent, and it declined by about 0.5% in the other group over a year, which is what you'd expect. So I think that the reason for me that exercise stands out a little bit above the rest of these kind of risk factors is that it is supported by this kind of clinical trial evidence. Now, the trials so far have mainly been in people at risk, but there are now a couple of large European studies that are looking at this in more detail. Next slide, please. I think one of the things that's disappointing is the potential impact of diet other than being substantially overweight. I mean, being substantially overweight is clearly a risk, But beyond that, although again, a lot of the myth is that, you know, kind of vitamin supplements might be fantastic, you know, eating fish oils might be great, there's actually very, very little evidence to support that from the large epidemiological studies. There is one, a couple of years ago, one randomized controlled trial that was led in Oxford called the Viticog study, which has been much talked about and did suggest that there would be some benefits. Now, this study focused on a group of people with mild cognitive impairment, so people who were at high risk of developing Alzheimer's disease over the next 1 to 5 years. And they were randomized to be either treated with B vitamins or to carry on with their kind of with a placebo and their usual diets. Now, overall, there was no significant benefit. But when you looked at the group of people who had something called elevated homocysteine, which is an indicator of low B vitamins, that subgroup of individuals who had the elevated homocysteine did get some benefit in terms of cognitive outcomes and in the rate of brain atrophy, brain shrinkage over the course of the study. But I think what this suggests is not that, you know, at a population level, taking B vitamins is going to sort out the problem of dementia. What it suggests is that, you know, what should be happening is that when people go with early memory problems to their GP, the GP should be checking their vitamin levels, their homocysteine, and treating it if it's low. And this is suggesting that treating low vitamin levels or indications of low vitamin levels is an important thing to do, but it's not an important primary prevention strategy. And probably diet isn't really the way to do it. Next slide, please. So I think before we go on to kind of medical kind of factors, I think my summary of that would be, unfortunately, it's probably not drinking alcohol and eating curry. It's probably the same old boring story that it's things that are unpleasant and hard, like exercising more and keeping your weight under control, that actually make a difference. And it's probably exercising your body rather than your brain that's actually important. So what about secondary prevention? What about kind of risk factors that might lead to dementia? Well, we know there are quite a few. High blood pressure in midlife, stroke, diabetes, high cholesterol in midlife are all really important risk factors for later dementia and significantly increase the risk. And I think I particularly want to focus on hypertension and hypercholesteremia. Because although we have best practice guidelines, you know, if you look at NICE guidelines, they're very clear what should happen, but yet they're not policed as rigorously as they should be. Probably something like a third of people actually get treated rigorously according to NICE standards for high blood pressure or high cholesterol. Now, these risk factors don't seem to apply as much once people get past about 65. If you look at the studies in older individuals, if you get to 65 without high blood pressure or high cholesterol, developing it at that stage probably might not be good for your overall health, but it's not probably a risk factor for dementia. So it's actually treating it in midlife that's really important. So I think if we're going to actually give people benefit from that, we somehow need to get the message across that, first of all, people should be going to their GPs more and getting their blood pressure and cholesterol checked. And secondly, for a whole variety of reasons, not just dementia, that we should be encouraging GPs to kind of treat these to really rigorous best practice standards, because it will make a difference. Next slide, please. So I guess that's the kind of, that's the more sort of traditional prevention bit of it. The other kind of aspect of prevention that's been much talked about is the idea of drugs that modify the disease course of particularly Alzheimer's disease. And particularly if you can combine that with early diagnosis, if you can diagnose people in the preclinical stages of the disease that I was talking about, where there's some disease process going on in the brain, but people don't have the full-blown clinical syndrome, if you can treat it at that point, can you delay it or even prevent it in an ideal scenario? Next slide, please. So I guess there are a lot of things going on, but there's a sort of what's been talked about as a cascade, which is the prevailing hypothesis. So this probably starts with a protein called amyloid that we all have in our brains. It's part of cell membranes. It's an important functional protein. But what seems to happen is this protein starts to aggregate together into clumps. The small clumps are toxic to nerve cells. The small clumps develop into bigger clumps. There are a variety of pathways that lead to that damaging neurons, and within the nerve cells in particular, a protein called tau, which is the skeleton of the nerve cell, begins to dysfunction. And once that tangles up, the nerve cells can't move nutrients up and down, they can't sustain themselves, the nerves themselves start to become dysfunctional and then die. There's a lot of other things going on. That seems to be what most people think is the core process. But around about, you've got a whole load of other things happening. You've got a lot of inflammation going on in the brain. You've got a lot of the processes that normally in a healthy brain are leading to nerve cells replenishing, regenerating a little bit, the connections between them regenerating. Those processes are being altered. The mitochondria that provide the energy for nerve cells are starting to become dysfunctional. So you've got a whole load of different things going on around it, making it more complicated. But most people think that that's the kind of central cascade. Next slide, please. Now, because of that, and because that amyloid protein was thought to be kind of the first major event in that cascade, a very, very high proportion of attempts to develop new treatments have focused on that amyloid part of it. And unfortunately, so far, they haven't been very successful. And I think that, well, I'll come back to the reasons for that. Now, this was a list in 2008 of treatments that were in phase three clinical trials. The ones in red are ones that have subsequently failed. So that looks like pretty grim reading, really, when you look through it. I don't think it's quite as grim as it looks, because we do have about 25 treatments in slightly earlier phase two clinical trials, and I think a lot of companies have been waiting to see what happens with the large vaccine trials that have just concluded before deciding how to progress, and I think we will see more of those compounds moving forward. But nevertheless, you know, it's not a pretty sight. The pharmaceutical industry is clearly worried about the lack of successes coming out of these phase three trials. I don't think in some ways it's particularly surprising, because across all areas of medicine, the hit rate of final phase trials to successful treatments is about 1 in 10. So you actually need quite a lot of trials to lead to a successful treatment. And although, you know, this looks like a reasonable number of trials, and 25 trials in phase 2 trial stage looks like a lot, if you compare that to cancer, there are 1,760 trials currently at phase 2 level. So there's an incredible inequity in the number of trials focusing on Alzheimer's disease compared to the number of trials focusing on cancer. Now, I think the ones that failed recently, the two antibody trials, bapineuzumab and solanezumab, I think there's a kind of a bit of a double-edged sword with these. Now, these are treatments which are antibodies to the amyloid itself, and which kind of remove the amyloid from the brain. And that's a kind of simple approach in many ways, but that's the kind of the theory by why they work. I think there have been several things that have undermined that a little bit. Clive Holmes from Southampton published a very nice paper a few years ago suggesting that with one of the earlier vaccine treatments, although it very effectively cleared the amyloid from the brain, it didn't actually lead to any improvement in the clinical outcomes in the individuals. So that suggests that maybe more than just changing the amyloid is necessary to actually improve outcomes for individuals. The one that's the most difficult to interpret is solanezumab, because although the trials didn't meet their primary outcome points defined statistically, when you pool the data from four trials and looked at them together, there was a suggestion that people with earlier levels of cognitive impairment did get some benefit, and the company, Lilly, that manufactures the product have made quite a lot out of that. Now, my colleagues might disagree with my interpretation of this, but I think at one level it's encouraging, because at a proof of concept level, it shows that doing something to amyloid did have some effect, even a weak effect. But in terms of actually being a viable therapy, it's actually less than a third as effective as the current drugs we have licensed, like Aricept. And it costs about £20,000 to give it. So no treatment, Aricept now costs about 25p a day. So, you know, nobody's going to pay for a treatment that's £20,000 a year, that's a third as effective as a treatment that's less than 30p. So I think that's absolutely dead in the water. Now, people are talking about treating earlier. The trials they've already done, just the final phase clinical trial program, already cost £100 million. If you go earlier, where you have to follow up people for longer because they're declining more slowly, where they're harder to identify, it's going to cost several billion to do that study. I just think it's a fantasy, personally. I don't think there's any way it can happen. Treating early with a simple treatment, if you had exercise, it's cheap, you could get it to people easily. Now, that treating early is viable. Giving people a B vitamin, if they've got vitamin deficiency, that's viable. Treating people that early when they have to have brain scans to diagnose it and the treatment costs £20,000 is a fantasy. Sorry, next slide, please. So why have they failed? I mean, we could have the wrong target. I don't think that's true. I think it's possibly true that it's such a complicated disease process that actually just treating one particular part of it isn't enough, and we need to do a little bit more than that. I think it's probably true that the current drugs that we've tried haven't been potent enough on the targets, and we probably need better drugs. There's a lot of opinion that it's too late in the disease process. I'm not sure I personally believe that. I think it depends on the target, and there might be other targets to do with the tangling of the tau protein in the neurons, for example, that might be a perfectly viable target a bit later on in the disease process. I think it's possibly true that the trial populations aren't homogeneous enough. If you look at who are the people with dementia, the vast majority of them are people over 80. Most people over 80 with dementia don't just have Alzheimer's disease, they have vascular changes, they have other things going on in the brain. And it may be that if you really want a therapy that's focusing on a single disease process to work, you have to try it first in a slightly more focused group of people that might be a younger group of people with clear biomarkers like brain imaging that they have the disease process that you're looking at. I think there's also been a little bit of rose-tinted interpretation of early clinical phase trials, and I think we need to be more ruthless about saying trials haven't worked, rather than, you know, multiple analysis until somebody finds something that looks a little bit encouraging. But I think overall we just haven't had enough trials. Sorry, next slide, please. How am I doing on time? Yeah. Next slide, please. So the phase three trials of the immunotherapy have failed. There are trials of slightly different immunotherapy things in progress, which I think have looked a little bit better in early phase trials and may be quite interesting. I think one of the advantages of the failed approaches is that we are beginning to see broader approaches across a range of different targets, and I personally think that's much more healthy. And finally, I just want to talk about a personal hobby horse of mine, which is drug repositioning. Can I have the next slide, please? And we've just recently completed quite a large kind of systematic review and expert consensus, looking at drugs that are licensed for other conditions and looking whether any of them have evidence that they might be any good for Alzheimer's disease. And you can see that there are actually five that probably stack up quite well from what we know. And a few of these are already now funded into clinical trials that will be starting next year. And diabetes treatments like liraglutide and Xcending look particularly promising, as do some of the antihypertensives. And I think the big advantage of this is that these are already licensed compounds, so they're relatively cheap. We know they're safe because they've already been through all the safety trials, and most compounds fail because of safety rather than lack of efficacy. And it also enables academia and the charity sector to contribute to the drug discovery effort. And from first discovery, for first identification of a molecule, a novel molecule, right through to the end stage clinical trials takes about 20 years. Whereas if you're doing it with a repositioned compound, you can achieve the same thing in 6 to 7 years. So it cuts down the time factor quite a lot. So I feel not necessarily that this should be the only approach, but that it's an important approach to complement what's happening in the pharmaceutical industry. Next slide, please, I think. Yeah, so I think, if summarising overall, I think increasing exercise, reducing weight, better management of high blood pressure and cholesterol in midlife, I think there's good evidence that those can reduce risk of dementia. That's not going to sort out the problem, but even if you kind of take a conservative estimate, it could probably reduce the incidence rates by something like 2 to 5% a year. And that 100,000 people develop dementia every year in the UK, so it could stop 2 to 5,000 people developing it. So even though it's a modest effect, it could be a very important one. I think we can use current treatments more effectively. I think there are some emerging treatments on the horizon, but we need a lot more trials. We need to be more ruthless, and we need to have higher standards of clinical trial design to give them the best chance of working. And on that point, I will shut up. Thank you.
Hello,
Thank you very much to our two speakers so far. We now move into the next part of the proceedings, which is a panel discussion. So I'd like to welcome the panel who's seated in front of me to come to the front.
Right, well, we now have our panel discussion. And what I'd like to do, if it's okay with everyone, is to ask members of the panel to say a short presentation of their view, and then we'll open up for the panel discussion. So could I start with you, Martin Green, who is the Independent Sector Dementia Champion.
Thank you, Sally. And as Sally said, I'm the Department of Health's Independent Sector Dementia Champion, but I'm also the Chief Executive of the English Community Care Association, which is a representative body for care homes. And so some of the themes that were picked up by Claire Goodman, I will perhaps pick up in some of the opening remarks that I want to make. In her opening remarks, Sally mentioned the fact that we had a Prime Minister's challenge on dementia. And I think this gives us an opportunity to reposition where dementia is in relation to society, and also that this is going to be an enormous challenge for the health and social care system, because not only do we need to reposition where society sees dementia, but we also need to start thinking differently about how we use particularly the resources in health and social care to make better impacts and to give people who are living with dementia the best possible life. One of the first things I want to say is that there is a hugely disproportionate allocation of resources in relation to health and social care. We have about 130 plus billion in health and about 8 billion in social care. And that imbalance certainly doesn't reflect, for example, the majority of people who have long-term conditions, where we cannot go down the old road which the health service had, which was diagnose, intervene, cure. We're now in a situation where people might have a diagnosis, they might have interventions, but the challenge is how they live well with their long-term conditions, and there aren't options at the moment for cure. So I think we need to redefine, first of all, our allocation of resources, and also recognise that if we're going to have lots of people living with long-term conditions, we need to apportion our resources into that space. I think it's also a great challenge, though, for people who deliver services, because we need to start thinking about different and more creative ways of delivering services. So, for example, care homes, which do a great job, and Claire in her presentation showed this, of supporting and enabling people, particularly in the final stages of life, many of whom have dementia. But we also need to recognise that if we're going to deliver a very much greater support system, we need to use the resources we have in different ways. So I want to see the care home become the hub for the management of long-term conditions within communities. I want to see care homes that not only provide residential care, but might be providing things like emergency respite, day support services, night support services. Interestingly, we have a lot of people who have dementia, challenging behaviour, and also nocturnal patterns. And what we need are systems that will enable those people to be better supported and also enable their carers to offer more support to them in that sphere. So I think big challenges for health, big challenges for social care, big challenges for society, because we've got to start addressing the issues of stigma in relation to dementia. But I also think there's a big challenge about inequalities in relation to people with dementia and how they're supported. If you pull out care plans for people who are younger adults with a range of different issues like autism or learning disabilities, you will see care plans that talk about enabling them to have a life. If you pull out care plans, particularly domiciliary ones, for people who are older with dementia, they're all about get them up, get them washed, get them dressed, feed them, oh, and by the way, do it in 30 minutes. So there is a really big equalities issue here, and I'm delighted that Baroness Greengross is chairing this event in her role as an equality commissioner. This is something that she has picked up on. So I think society needs to be really clear about some of those issues. The final thing I want to say is that we've got to support carers better. So, for example, we need the government to think about its financial packages to carers. So why is it that people can get tax relief on nursery placements but can't get them on daycare services for when they're looking after somebody who has a dementia or a long-term condition? So we need to align our processes to make sure that they are age-neutral, condition-neutral, and that they support the notion of caring, whether it's for a child or whether it's for somebody with dementia. And the final point I want to say, picking up on some of the issues that Clive raised about research, Clive's absolutely right. We need more money and more emphasis on research. But I want that research to be balanced. So we need research which is about the issues of cure and treatment, but we also need research on the issue of care. So we spend a lot of time looking at some of the issues about whether or not a medical intervention will work, but we've also got to recognise there are people at the moment dealing with people who have challenging behaviour, for example, and we need research on what works so that you can support those people effectively. There is a long-term goal for research, but we must also remember there is an issue and a problem that is today's problem, and I want the research money to support people who are living with dementia now as much as it supports people who might develop the condition in the future. So those were my overarching comments, Lady Greengross.
Thank you very much, Martin. Thank you for bringing up the unequal or really discriminatory treatment between old and younger people. That's, and also, I should say that there's an opportunity here for carers because the Care and Support Bill, which is just coming to the House of Lords now, going through Parliament, is going to give legal rights to carers equal with the cared for person. So there are opportunities for us to really take this forward. It'd be good in this discussion if we can. But thank you for bringing up those inequalities and indeed, I think, discriminatory practices. That's really good. So I'm sure they'll come up later. And also your vision for the care home, which I share, and which perhaps we can discuss as well. And I'm really pleased now to turn to Raphael Wittenberg, who's from the London School of Economics. It's lovely that you're here, Raphael. Can I turn to you?
The Dementia UK reporting is ready to be mentioned and will no doubt be very familiar. So just by way of sort of background reminder of it, this report, edited by Martin Knapp and Martin Prince and published in 2007, found there were about 700,000 people with dementia in the UK at that time, about 1.1% of the population. And also found that the cost of dementia to the UK society, UK economy, is about 70 billion.
Thank you. And that would be probably over 19 billion now at today's prices. About a third of that related to informal care. So setting that aside and looking at the formal care side of it, that would be about correspond to about 0.8% of GDP. So a not by no means insignificant proportion of the economy's output relating to dementia care. And the cost is about £25,000 per person with dementia per year. So having just reminded of those sort of background statistics from the Dementia UK report, I'd like to make four points related to research, please. First of all, on the lifetime costs of care, with colleagues at the LSE, we've been looking at the lifetime costs of long-term care for a person aged 65, i.e. how much resources are likely to be spent on that person's care over the rest of their lifetime. We found that the average is about £35,000 per the expectation of care expenditure for a person at age 65 on average over the rest of their lifetime. And that's relevant to discussions, for example, about the funding of care and the Dilnot report, for example. But there's a huge skewed distribution. About 10% of people aged 65 will, in the course of the rest of their lives, receive care services or purchase care services of a value exceeding £100,000. I'm not aware of equivalent data specifically on dementia, but I expect that quite a lot of the people in that 10% with the high lifetime costs would be people who have subsequently developed dementia. So it's an area there where it might be useful to have more research evidence. Second, on care homes, which have already been mentioned very considerably today, Martin Knapp and colleagues found that about 40% of their 17 billion costs related to the costs of care homes. 40%, and about a third of the people with dementia in this country are residents in care homes, as has been mentioned. So one interesting issue is there a scope to delay admissions to care homes, or indeed prevent them perhaps, through better care earlier, through better earlier identification, earlier diagnosis of dementia care? There is some evidence, I think, both from the US and this country that that may be the case. And in work with Subi Banerjee, Subi and I looked at the modeling of the potential effects on societal costs and benefits if care home stays could be reduced by an average of 10%, and found both there'd be some savings to society and some benefits that could be valued and that probably be cost effective. But to do more work in this area, I think, would be of value. But if there's a change in the balance between care home and care in the community, clearly there'll be implications for carers, as has just been mentioned. Martin Knapp and Martin Prince found that about a third of their costs of 17 billion related to the opportunity costs on informal carers. Now, of course, the scope for debate as to how one puts a cost on informal care, and they do mention considerable sensitivity around this figure of about 6 billion, a third of the 17 billion. It would clearly be valuable, I think, to have more information about the impact and costs for carers, and also more evidence on the cost effectiveness and cost effectiveness of measures that might support carers looking after people with dementia. There's considerable research going on informal care, but I think there's rather less evidence on the effectiveness and cost effectiveness of care for carers, help for carers. Finally, I'd like to mention some of the work we've done on projecting future costs of care for people with dementia. One piece of work we did at the LSE suggested that these costs might rise from about 0.6% of GDP in 2002 to 1% or so by 2031. To inform this, we conducted a Delphi exercise seeking the opinion of about 25 experts on a number of issues around future dementia prevalence and future dementia care. They, for example, were optimistic that there might be at least some reduction in prevalence of dementia by age and gender over the years, that there might be a relative shift from care home care, residential care, to community care, but also felt that it was likely that the real wages of caring staff would need to rise to promote improved quality of care. And we found, looking at different scenarios around this, the increase might be to a bit less than 1% of GDP by 2031. Now, clearly, again, it would be extremely valuable to have more evidence on these issues and to be able to produce better projections of the likely impact on society in terms of costs under different patterns of care and potentially, of course, also different funding arrangements. So those are four areas, from my perspective as an economist, that I think it would be very valuable to pursue in further analysis and research.
Thank you very much. May I call you Ray? Is that how you're talking? Yes. Thank you. That was really interesting, and I think fits in so well with the current look at Andrew Dilnot's proposals, paying with a cap on the payment that people make for care, and comparing that with your data. Very, very interesting. Thank you, and I'm sure people here will want to discuss that with you. And now we have somebody from the Institute and Faculty of Actuaries. Where is he? Oh, there. Greg Becker. Over to you, Greg.
Good day. So my name is Greg Becker, and I work for a company called the Reinsurance Group of America in the private sector. I will be talking about my involvement with the actual profession and things like the ABI and looking at long-term care. but also the perspective of the actuary working, trying to solve these problems from the private sector. As you might be able to hear, I've got a foreigner accent. I'm from South Africa. And it's interesting to see how different solutions, different parts of the world are addressing this problem in different ways. Probably the first thing to look at would be is the question of, are private sector solutions, can they be created and can they meet the needs? And the answer is, of course, yes, they can. The problem is that they cost a lot of money. And the big problem is that it turns out that not many people, not a significant share of the population, has saved enough money to look after their private dementia needs on, when they get sick. The cost can be astounding, and I'm aware of cases of people living for 10 years with these illnesses at significant charges per week for bordering on £1,000 a week. That is a great example of something that people can protect against, and there's certainly things like risk pooling advantages. The problem is that because it happens to so many people, the risk pooling effect and things like the anti-selection effect can at times override the potential for the product to be launched, because everyone who will be purchasing the product will have a very significant premium. That's not to talk about something that we haven't spoken about significantly so far today, and that would be dementia at younger ages. And that's already been, it can be seen as part of certain critical illness policies because it's a meaningful percentage of those who develop dementia develop it prior to age 50. Of course, that's probably due to there being different causal pathways, and it's just one of the diseases that's under the umbrella that is called dementia. When looking at private sector provision, another key factor that is affecting the development within the UK of these products to meet these needs would have to be the regulatory uncertainty that has followed the Dilnot Commission. It's at the moment estimated that the Dilnot Commission will be looked at by the government again in great detail after the next election. I think it's in 2015. And until then, basically, insurance companies and reinsurance companies are questioning whether or not they should invest more money in trying to work out a solution that may have a very short life expectancy, excuse the pun. In terms of other products that can be created, people have been looking at annuities, which they call disability-linked annuities, which increase the payment in the event of illness. As again, the problem is that not enough people have saved enough for a disability-linked annuity to be able to cover the benefits. Things like critical illness benefits, it's common to have something called a child critical illness benefit, which pays for a person's needs, allows a parent to remain home and look after their children when they're ill. Having a similar benefit to deal with people looking after their parents, while would be very popular, you can imagine that it might be one of the largest benefits because people will take it out as they see their parents becoming old. I guess for me, those would be my comments. At the moment, the risk is that we need to get more certainty before we're able to take steps forward in the right direction. And while I would encourage all research on the medical front and research on the economic front, it's not going to take us away from some of the hard facts that probably will still remain.
Thank you very much, Greg. I think one of the reasons for many people supporting Andrew Dilnot's recommendations are that they give an opportunity for the insurance industry to provide long-term care cover, which would mean that people, because the insurance industry would know the risk, they could afford to do, which hasn't been the case until now. It doesn't work in the States, it doesn't work here. So certainly from my point of view, if we don't bring all the sectors in, we're not going to cope with this. So his recommendations open a door to a possibility. So thank you for those very important figures. We do have another person, Anna, who we're going to introduce now before we go over to our question and answer session. And I'm going to ask you, Tom, to introduce her.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Inspired by what Clive was saying about cognitive flexibility and problem solving, you will have noticed that we've been joined at the table by Professor Louise Robinson, who's Professor of Primary Care at the University of Newcastle, hot foot from the ministerial seminar on dementia. So we're going to
allow Louise time to give her presentation, and then we will reconvene for the discussion before, prior to closing. I think that's probably the best way of using the time that we have.
I really, really must apologise for my late entry, but unfortunately, Jeremy Hunt, I'm afraid, takes precedence over you, and when he changed the timing of the seminar, I was not a lady who could say no. But I think it's very pertinent that you're having this event about looking at the future challenges, not just for dementia care, but for research, because the very first question he asked this afternoon was, I want to know two things this afternoon from the experts gathered here. I want to know if there's going to be a cure for this illness in the foreseeable future, and if there isn't, I want to know what we need to do about improving the quality of care for these people urgently. Because if there's no cure, why are we wasting money trying to find it when we need to improve the quality of care? And at that moment, I thought, I like you, I could work with you, and he was going to listen. So what I'm going to do is give you a view from primary care. I'm going to touch a little bit on research, but with that aim in mind, I think it's really important that we concentrate on the here and now and the quality of care that people with dementia are getting. How many of you in the audience actually know personally somebody with dementia? Wow, we're almost at about 75%. So it touches all of us in some way or another. I think I have to put my hand up when I need my... I have to raise my hand and the slides will change. There we go. I'm just going to move briefly over this. You will have seen these figures. We have a Frankenstorm called dementia. Not far away, but not too far over the horizon. But just look at the bottom point on the slide. Two-thirds of these people will live in the community and be largely managed by their GP and primary healthcare teams. Out of all the chronic illnesses, the World Health Organization has labelled dementia as the illness with the greatest, if you like, global burden of disease. In terms of primary care, I'm afraid as GPs and primary care teams, our school report really has actually said could do a lot better over the last few years. And we're very, very conscious that we could do better. We certainly know that. But there are obvious reasons for this. A national survey in 2008 showed that only a third of GPs felt they had sufficient knowledge and skills to manage dementia. That's quite a frightening thought considering the numbers that we're now talking about. But actually, what have we been doing then? Because a number of international reviews published a couple of years ago showed that the GP has a huge role in the management of dementia, from actually case-finding people with suspicious symptoms, referring them to our specialist colleagues, ensuring they get the right treatments and support, supporting their families, huge, huge role for us in ensuring the carers are managed well, to actually end-of-life care and ensuring the person with dementia not only lives well with dementia, but dies well with dementia. So how can we do it better? There are multiple challenges for us. It's not an easy illness. For a start, most of us will find that we start to forget things as we get older. We forget people's names, we forget where we've left our glasses, on the top shelf of the fridge for me the other week. And it's all part of normal aging. But many of the very first symptoms of dementia resemble normal aging. So it's quite difficult for us as GPs, who are not experts in one illness, but if you like a jack of all trades, to actually pinpoint who we should actually investigate further. Saying the D word, I think this is a huge, huge issue. And it's not just relevant to us in primary care, but to my specialist colleagues as well. Actually, talking about dementia, it's probably the last medical stigma that we really need to challenge. Cancer, we managed it with 20 years ago, but we're still struggling very much with dementia. There's a sort of sense that there's a lack of options and care opportunities for people with dementia. The choice and the treatments just aren't out there like we can give people with other illnesses and with cancer. But the other thing is, people with dementia, as the illness progresses, will lose their ability to speak. And actually trying to care for people who can't voice what their concerns are, what their symptoms are, is hugely challenging, especially as you then have to go to their family and the next of kin to try and get some sense of what they might be feeling. And they're usually old, and they have lots of other chronic illnesses. And that all adds up to a huge complexity of care that's actually very challenging to manage. Challenging to manage in this kind of scenario. This just shows you the sort of workload that we do as GPs. We usually have about 2,000 patients attached to us as individuals. About a fifth of those will be over 65. We normally have about 7 to 8 minutes, although the Royal College of General Practitioners says it's now about 11, to deal with the problems, and I say problems in the plural, that patients will bring to us. If you look at the rate of consultation of people over 65, that's probably about 3 times that of the under 65s, and they take twice as long to deal with because they've got more illnesses. So it's already challenging for us to process those kind of problems within our current primary care setting. However, there is some light on the horizon. Because bizarrely, for someone who's been involved in dementia care for a long, long time, we seem to be having a bit of a Cinderella moment. There's been guidance for us as GPs from the National Institute of Excellence for many years now, and there's also been revised guidance on drugs. But I think one of the hugest, biggest things that's made a difference is the current interest in the government at actually promoting better care for people with dementia. I'm sorry, there's a slide missing there. I don't quite know what's happened. Anyway, this is actually the National Dementia Strategy, which was released in 2009. It shows you the sort of recommendations the National Dementia Strategy wanted. There are about 16, 17 in all, and they cover the whole of the dementia care pathway. As a GP, I'm involved in all of those areas, largely, so I can't dip out of any of them, really. I'm involved in all of them. But the other thing that's happened is, following on from this, just earlier this year, the Prime Minister announced that dementia was one of his key opportunities. And the Prime Minister's dementia challenge is actually raising awareness even more. So I'm just going to take some of these areas and show, if you like, where the current issues are in primary care, where we perhaps need to do more research and where we certainly need to improve care. Okay, in terms of diagnosis, and this was the very key area that Jeremy Hunt wanted to concentrate on this afternoon. How can we ensure that people get timely diagnosis of dementia? And there's certainly a lot of work going on about how we can do that. We know that to screen whole populations is not cost effective, but research is telling us that there are certain groups of people at more at risk of developing dementia. The biggest risk factor is age. However, there are also other factors, such as vascular risk factors, such as if you've got high blood pressure, if you smoke, if you've got diabetes. We know these people are at risk, and there's now an initiative to start to screen people in these groups and ask them if they actually have problems with their memory. We know enough about the factors that contribute to the onset of dementia to start to target these at-risk populations to hopefully pick up the illness earlier. The other thing that we're starting to build up more evidence about, but where there are still considerable research gaps, are interventions or treatments, if you like, very much focused around symptomatic treatment, not cure, that can improve the quality of life for people with dementia. There are drugs available, which I'm sure Clive has probably talked about, which are only unfortunately available to people with Alzheimer's disease, and there are lots of other types of dementia. So we need to start to think about how we can support people with other types of dementia and not using drugs. There are certainly increasing evidence for interventions, what's called cognitive rehabilitation and case management, but they're not out there in routine practice. So although we need to be thinking about what's the future of research, we also need to be thinking, how can we start to get some of this evidence-based intervention out into routine care? An area where we're starting to make good progress is in the management of behavioural problems in dementia. And a national primary care audit earlier this year showed that we'd reduced the prescribing of certain types of drugs, antipsychotic drugs, which we use to treat behavioural problems in dementia, by 50%. What we now need to do is find out, if you like, what other non-drug treatments represent the best treatment for these people if we stop prescribing drugs that were shown to be harmful to them. And another area in research which has been hugely neglected. I was a bit disappointed to see Jeremy Hunt concentrating so much on diagnosis, when really it's not just about diagnosis, it's about ensuring people live well with dementia and ensuring they die well with dementia. As a GP, people die with dementia and lots of other illnesses, and I see this on a daily basis, but they don't die quickly. This is a very slow trajectory. People will be dying slowly with dementia, and the quality of care that they get has been shown by research to be suboptimal in many cases. And this has been a huge area of neglected research in the UK. So, that's some areas where we need to do some further research, but what about improving care? Because we do have huge issues. We can't sustain the current models. We can't sustain the current funding models. And what we've been talking about this afternoon are some changes, whether that's a big radical shift or not, in how we manage people with dementia in the community to try and look at some of the health and social care costs and produce more effective care. And I would argue that as GPs, we need to do some changes, a bit like a very common doctor here in the UK. We can't just stay in a last century model. We have to evolve. We have to become better at caring for older people. The Royal College of General Practitioners has said that we need to offer 15-minute consultations, not 10-minute ones. It's also increased the length of training to 4 years for GPs, not 3 years, so that we have more experience to caring for older people. And we need to think about whether some of the skills that our colleagues in secondary care, people like Clive, whether we can actually share some of that responsibility so there's a more shared integrated care pathway out there for people with dementia and better coordination of care. I just want to touch on one model which we've discussed this afternoon, which is a completely different model of managing dementia care. Normally at the minute, it's largely coordinated by mental health care trusts in the UK. But there are some examples where these blurring of boundaries have been shifted. This is a model led by Dr. Ian Greaves, who's a GP in the Northwest. And what they did in collaboration with their old age psychiatry colleagues was have dementia care centred in primary care with a lead GP, a specialist nurse, and also, if you like, support from their old age psychiatrist. And the diagnosis was made as a more collaborative process with the GP and the specialist nurse doing a care plan and actually following up those patients through the rest of their illness. Some interesting facts from Ian, he's not done huge amounts of research, but just some locality figures show that this primary care-led integrated model of case management in dementia was much more cost effective than our traditional, if you like, referring to secondary care led models. And so certainly that was a model that we discussed this afternoon. Okay, so what I think we need to do is not just think about where the future gaps are in research for dementia, but we have a much more immediate problem. We need to quickly think about how we deliver better care, more integrated care to this population of people who we're currently not serving at all well and who are costing us, in terms of illness burden and costs to the health and social care service, huge amounts and will cost us more. So I'm going to argue that we need to forget research for a minute. We need to think about looking at existing research to think about how we can do better care for these people, and that's long overdue. We need to perhaps to think more laterally. We need to think about sharing responsibility with our colleagues. And we need to think about blurring the boundaries between health and social care, which in the majority of cases in this country are very separate entities with very separate funding streams. I just want to draw your attention to some research that was done in the States, which was actually what we call an integrated healthcare model. And this, can you go back one, please? And this study actually showed that if you have community, if you like, shared care, with a GP, an expert nurse, and a social worker working very closely in the community with support from their specialist care colleagues, that you can vastly improve quality of healthcare and quality of life for vulnerable older people, many of whom have cognitive impairment. And what I've been arguing for this afternoon is that we perhaps need to think beyond the box for these people, because it's not just about healthcare, it's actually about integrated social and healthcare. Okay, so there's multiple challenges. sorry, there's multiple challenges for us. I've alluded to some of them. These are just some of the areas I've covered, and I would suggest that there are some solutions. I would suggest that there are some solutions that we need to think about. Away from research, but more immediate than the research will take, but looking at what current evidence we've got and trying to improve what we can do. We need to think about improving the diagnosis. We need to get raise GPs' knowledge and awareness. We need to make the process of people getting assessments much quicker and speedier. We need to think about the skills that are available in primary care, and it may be that we need to expand that skill base and make the GP more of a geriatrician than they currently have been. And we need a huge attitudinal shift about saying openly that people have dementia and not using euphemistic terms to actually hide behind what we're currently doing. We need very much to support the carer, not just the patient with dementia. There's huge evidence to show that carers' physical and mental health is greatly affected by caring for someone with dementia. And we need to put more research into end-of-life care, which has been currently neglected, in order to improve services. And we need a national care service, not a national health service. Thank you.
We have now a huge amount, I think, for people to ask questions about, and we've got about 40 minutes, so it's now over to everybody who's here to let us know what you think and what your ideas are. So can I ask you just to say who you are, and then put questions to the panel. If it's one person in particular, do say. If not, we'll get a few questions and then address, see who they're best addressed to. Would somebody like to start us off? Yes.
Right, good evening. My name's Ken Crawford. I belong to something called Devon Senior Voice, and we're an older person's organisation in Devon. David Cameron's only just caught up with us, because effectively we've been doing dementia awareness since 2008. We're on our fifth Dementia Awareness Day. We've put in an extra 32 memory cafes, so we're working well. One of the things that we have done in the past 6 months, we're a part of a bid for Health Watch. So what I would like to ask the panel is, can they give some advice to potential Health Watches as to how we deal with dementia, not just the research, but how we help with the treatment?
Thank you very much.
I don't think you know what Health Watch is.
You don't know what Health Watch is. Right, well, you explain it. I mean, I can or Martin. Well, it's the monitoring of healthcare from the patient's point of view, and there's it can take place at a national level, but this is at a local trust level.
One of the things I think you can usefully do, Mr. Crawford, is not only challenge around some of the qualities and outcomes from the system, but also challenge the system as to how it's configured and why it's doing particular things. So you might want to challenge the apportionment against health as opposed to social care. You might want to challenge whether or not those services are integrated. So I think I would be bold in broadening the remit and defining ways in which you think you can have an impact. Broadening your remit and defining ways in which you think you can have an impact that will actually benefit people with dementia and their carers. So don't be too constrained, because one of the things about Health Watch is it's very fluid. There are some directions of travel, but I think there's all to play for.
Thank you very much. I think a lot of people will get involved in Health Watch.
Yes, and I think it is also that we, ironically, there is quite a lot of resource out there. It's not just terrifically well mobilised. I mean, the Alzheimer's Society, for one, there are a lot of recommendations and policy guidance about dementia champions and how they should be working across health services. And Health Watch could actually just be looking to see if they're actually doing what they should be doing in terms of creating dementia-friendly environments in NHS settings. It would be a start.
Tom, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, I think there is a lot of will around to do better. There is a lot of recognition and a lot of will to do better, so that when, for example, in the East Midlands, they did a consultation with stakeholders in relation to the establishment of an academic health science network. They consulted about 150 different stakeholders, and they all came back saying, well, it's about frail older people, this is the priority. The way I would start to approach it, I think, in a kind of local setting is to regard dementia in a sort of developmental way as a pathway, and there's a slide that Louise showed from National Dementia Strategy, which has got this sort of time arrow in it. And I think that's really important, because you need different things at different times. You need different people, and you need different forms of inquiries. From the point of view of research, you need different sort of researchers looking at different parts of the pathway. So you have to keep the pathway, I think, as a whole in view in order to deciding this, making these tricky choices about the apportionment of resources. And although I'm a doctor and a psychiatrist, and I diagnose lots and lots of people with as having dementia, that's what I do. It's disappointing if that's the only string to the bow, because it's arguable as to what the benefits are of being diagnosed as something unless there is a story to follow it.
Thank you very much. Would somebody else like to make a point? Yes, gentleman there.
Vlada Koch of Life Planning Associates. My father was in Devon, and the thing that I'm very pleased to hear today was the recognition of a collaborative approach and looking longitudinally rather than horizontally in terms of the issues. I wonder whether some research could be put into early stage AIDS or something like that could help. If I used to say my parents as an example, father wanted to drive, but every time he went to the doctor with my mother, the doctor seemed to conspire with my father and say he was quite all right. And I wonder whether there's an easy way, rather than relying on a yes-no answer, to actually detect the early signs of dementia.
I mean, that's the kind of golden question, really, that, you know, everyone wants to detect it early. Although I think we've got to kind of set realistic standards, because at the moment, in the UK, we only at any stage of the dementia diagnose 40-something percent of people. So, you know, more than half of people with dementia never get diagnosed, not just early. So I think we have to kind of address that issue first, which is a lot of the things that Louise was talking about. I think the technologies are there to move diagnosis a little bit earlier. I mean, there are now criteria we can, with more detailed psychological testing, with brain scanning, by looking at blood and spinal fluid, all of those things, we can be pretty accurate in people who have certain types of memory problem, probably for up to 5 years before they develop what we would currently call dementia. I think that there are two problems with that, though. One, it requires the person themselves to identify they have something the matter, and then somebody else has to refer that person for more detailed testing, and then there has to be the facility to do that more detailed testing. So I don't. The technology exists, but the real life problems and barriers to getting it done aren't the technologies. It's actually, you know, the real life barriers of people going to their doctors, the doctors passing them on, and the facilities being available.
Yes, please, and then.
I think the other thing we need to talk about, it's not just about the diagnosis or getting the diagnosis, it's then discussing the diagnosis. And I think there's huge, huge shifts to be made, both professionally and amongst the general public. We've just done a very interesting exercise in my practice where we've looked at our dementia register, so the people with known dementia who are listed on our register who we care for. And we then searched for the number of people who were taking dementia drugs, and found another 42 people who were taking dementia drugs who we didn't know about, in theory, or were on our dementia register for follow-up and recall. And when we looked back, these are people who hadn't been labelled as having dementia. They had cognitive impairment or neurodegenerative disease, but they were taking dementia treatment. And as GPs, we'd obviously colluded with that. And so this thing about discussing the diagnosis, why is it so different to say to somebody, you have dementia. I tell people they have multiple sclerosis. I tell them they have Parkinson's disease. What is the big issue about saying dementia? I'm not really sure, but until we can beat that, there's no point in making a diagnosis. And I see that so frequently. I see carers behind me going, you know, and you're just about to say it and discuss it. But, you know, so there is a huge, huge inhibition at all levels which we need to break over. And until we can do that, making a diagnosis, if we can't talk about it, is not going to make much difference.
Yes, Greg, you wanted to...
So a brief comment from me, speaking as an actuary. Many of our products, we have a claims trigger. A life insurance policy, when you die, and that's the obvious one, it's very easy to check. Critical illness and long-term care, that's when the difficulty starts to arrive. When it comes to physical impairments, we use something called activities of daily living, and that's a relatively useful measure, and it can not be biased. The difficulty, though, is when it comes to someone with your mental impairments, because at times you'll have a person that won't fail any of the ADLs, yet will be suffering from dementia. The next thing is, when we start talking about all these other tests we can start to deal with, spinal fluids and all these types of things, the problem is because there's so many conditions that fall under the umbrella called dementia, each of these tests might not identify all of them, so you wind up in this very grey area. And as soon as you wind up in the grey area, that's when you wind up in a place where actuaries don't like to be.
Yeah. There's a lady here who I know wanted to make a point.
Carol Jagger, Newcastle University. I want to challenge something that Clive said, and also that, don't wipe your forehead too quickly, Greg, because you mentioned it as well, about younger people with dementia. You mentioned specifically younger people with dementia and that, you know, maybe we could model, it was different, and maybe we could sort of start with that, it was easier. And Clive, you mentioned about trial populations not being homogeneous and that maybe treatment should be tested on younger populations who with dementia because they were cleaner in a way. And I'd like to say that I think we're in the problem that we are with treatments for many things, because most treatments are trialled on younger populations, and now we have very old people who are rather different, and we don't know whether treatments behave the same, or even whether the cut points for definitions of hypertension or whatever are the same for very old people, and that's where a lot of the dementia is. So I would say I'm not sure that trialing treatments on younger populations is going to help very old population.
I would see it as a two-stage process, because at the first stage, if you like, is a proof of concept, that if you've got a drug which has a particular or a some sort of therapeutic which has a particular mechanism, you know, in order in the first place to see whether there might be any potential benefit of that, it feels like you have to give it the best chance of giving benefit, which is going to be in people who clearly have something going wrong which is related to the target that drug is working on. I agree absolutely that doesn't then tell you whether that same drug is going to work in a group of people with a different range of things, more complicated things, combinations of things going on. But it feels to me like you have to do that as a second stage. Otherwise, you know, you're immediately setting your treatment up to fail before you get past the first hurdle.
But, Clive, are there people who are looking at the different results for, say, Pick's disease or some of the others that do tend to attack younger people?
I think there are, definitely, but I think that, I mean, Alzheimer's disease is a Cinderella area until sort of, you know, there have been some increase in investment recently, but until very recently there's been very little invested. And, you know, the figures that I showed about trials, if you compare it to cancer, it's a pitiful number of studies. Mm. But if you compare Alzheimer's disease to other dementias are nowhere in the picture. Mm. I mean, at the moment there are no ongoing trials in vascular dementia. There are no disease-modifying therapies in Parkinson's dementia or dementia with Lewy bodies being investigated. You know, the other dementias that are slightly rarer, we don't even have symptomatic trials of any size. So there's only one reasonable size trial looking at people with Down syndrome who develop dementia. So I think that, you know, I think actually once we move away from Alzheimer's disease, that it's an absolutely pitiful scene, and we desperately need more studies in that space.
I mean, there are some quite big practical issues around trials. I mean, I think what Carol Jagger is saying is really important, that it's very important that older people are not excluded from clinical trials. We've talked about other forms of discrimination, and that's been another one historically. So that's important. It's important that once a drug has been identified as being kind of plausible, that it is tried on the large, you know, a large and pragmatic population. But I think that involving people with dementia in research is in itself somewhat sometimes difficult, because particularly if you're looking at anything other than the early stages of dementia, there may be issues about capacity. There are certainly issues about decision making by carers on behalf of people with Alzheimer's disease, and they tend, in general, to be much more protective of the person with dementia than they would be in making the same sort of decisions for themselves. So you often find that you might wish to include somebody, a particular person with Alzheimer's disease, in your trial, but the carer gets in the way. So So I think the lesson there comes back to something that was said just now about attitudes. I think there is a lot that we need to do with the public about attitudes, about changing the situation where your chance of being involved in research if you've got dementia is minimal.
Absolutely. There's a gentleman here who I think wanted to come in.
Thank you. My name's Hughes. The reason for being here as a guest, over the last 52 years, I have had a close involvement with three members of the family, two totally different forms of dementia. And I'm delighted to hear you mention and emphasize the breadth of dementias. I'm not saying it just Alzheimer's. Now, I've also had experience as an independent counselor in a London borough and on an organization that monitors the health service in two London boroughs. And so much of what you've said comes across to what I've learned at first hand. And the thing I'd like to raise is this whole question of the coordination, because I'm actually attending a meeting in my borough next week where I'm the guy, the independent guy, who's trying to bring still together the NHS and the council. And a very good example is the attitude towards Dementia UK and their superb service with Admiral Nurses, where the council say, oh, they're nurses, so NHS should pay. NHS say, no, they're called nurses, so vice versa. Result, they're made redundant, which is absolutely, totally showing a lack of understanding. Now, I'd like to come to the key point. That is the present status quo. But recently, at the monitoring organization, had three chairmen of CCGs, the new doctors' organization. And my experience with doctors is, as has been said, sadly, their knowledge of dementia and the breadth of them, yes, they will understand Alzheimer's, but the others, you might as well talk in the dark to them. What is a serious concern is if the change in the NHS goes ahead, and if council's budgets stay as they are, what will dementia truly action be taken? Are we seeing from the government a lot of talk? What we actually have to see is some doing, and that cannot be done without more funding. So you're all members of organizations, which I hope would be fighting for that, at grassroots level people like myself are. But it's this lack of total, proper, real, instead of blaming the other part of the thing, doctors blame council, social service blame, get together. I'm involved with a meeting next week in my borough, trying to do just that.
Well, good luck. Martin, I think that one is for you.
Well, I think, Mr. Hughes, you're absolutely right. And part of the problem is that we have fragmented budgets. And whilst we have fragmented budgets, we will get people who will defend them as their line in the sandpoint, because of course that's what they're there to do. So I think one of the challenges is to get to a point where we start commissioning for outcomes, regardless of which bit of the service it is. Like you, I'm a little bit depressed about these new structures, and I wish governments would spend as much money on attitudinal and organisational change rather than structural change. You know, they spend so much time rearranging people's offices and thinking about whether they'll put this headed paper or that headed paper. And I had a very depressing thing happen to me, which illustrates the point. I went to a meeting to discuss the development of a new approach to dementia care. And the meeting started with half a dozen people telling me their title today and telling me their title, which would be the thing they would have in 6 months' time. And I thought, if we rearrange the chairs on the Titanic, we will still get a sinking ship. So I do think that the whole system needs to start thinking in different ways and start to be monitoring and rewarding on outcomes rather than just on the particular service that people get.
But Martin, is it not possible that with the primary care level, with local commissioning groups and health and wellbeing boards, that it's there that the budgets could be mixed and then we could get integrated care?
Well, I think that's eminently possible in the structure. The problem is some of the individuals who are going to be making the decisions, exactly as you say, Mr. Hughes, don't understand anything about the social care agenda. And particularly when you're a clinician faced with the reality of not being able to do very much in terms of treatment or cure, what you then have to do, and what I hope they will do in those commissioning groups, is say, well, how do we ensure people live well with their dementia, get the correct medical intervention, but also get the correct interventions around social care. And that was exactly why I made the point about the fact that we needed to get this disproportionate approach, with one lot of the system having enormous amounts of the budget and the other part of the system having small amounts.
Sheila, you wanted to come in. Thank you.
Thank you. Can you hear me? Sheila Peace. I'm currently president-elect of the British Society of Gerontology, but that's not the point to make. A number of things. I'm not going to talk about social care. I was reflecting on communication between medics. I'm a person with type 1 diabetes, which I've had for the last 30 years. Now, why am I telling you this? You've talked about obesity, you've talked about exercise, you've talked about hypertension, cholesterol. Those are all issues that I talk about to my diabetic consultant a lot. I'm on a lot of that medication that's brought my cholesterol right down, and I try and do the exercise. And I'm conscious of the liaison between the medics and the other carers involved with different long-term conditions. Because actually I'm saving money here. Some of the treatment I have for a different condition may have an effect on another condition. But obviously I'm conscious of what you're saying about diabetes and risk factors. So I think there's a life course issue. I'm very concerned about attitudes, about the ageism that's associated with a condition. And yet, if people who are younger, who may be able to see some of these things and the knock-on effects, then maybe we might have a better opportunity. So I suppose I was reflecting on the way in which this kind of notion of comorbidity really needs to be addressed.
Thank you, Sheila. You want to come in, Clive?
I absolutely agree with that. I think there's all kinds of ways that things could be more effective. I think a lot of the specialists dealing with things that we know to be risk factors for different types of dementias, probably, that's another important place where the prevention but also early diagnosis could happen. And I think it's not just in primary care. I think there's also a whole kind of issues of specific things, but I think for me the one really, really important issue is vascular dementia. And I think people with vascular dementia often fall horribly between stools. I mean, as a psychiatrist, I would acknowledge that, you know, maybe psychiatrists are very good at treating some of the psychiatric symptoms, behavioural symptoms, helping as part of multidisciplinary teams to think about social care packages, but probably very, very bad at managing vascular risk factors, blood pressure, cholesterol. You know, our stroke and geriatric medicine colleagues will be very good at managing those things and not so good at some of the other things. And people kind of, you know, it's a bit of a lottery. They get half of what they need well and half badly, whichever of those specialties they go to. And somehow we need a sort of more joined up way of doing that.
We certainly do. Thank you, Louise.
I'm going to use your diabetes to illustrate another point. Many years ago, when I first qualified as a GP, when I diagnosed a new diabetic, they immediately went to the hospital. Now we have a very, very different model. The majority of people with diabetes are managed the majority of the time by their general practitioners, with a specialist nurse who has been trained with the aid of a dietitian who visits the diabetic clinic and a chiropodist. People with insulin-dependent diabetes, yes, go to the hospital because they've got a different aspect of diabetes, but 60% of diabetics are entirely managed by general practitioners and an extended team of specialists who work together, but link with the secondary care people when they're struggling to help manage with that person. And I would suggest, and it's my one suggestion that I made to Jeremy Hunt this afternoon, that we need to reframe dementia. If we reframe dementia as a chronic illness that people will live with, not as an illness to be hidden away or that people die with, but if we reframe it as a chronic illness that requires a coordinated care approach, largely based in the community, but with help from specialist colleagues when it's complicated or it's difficult, then I think we could make big savings, and I think we could change people's perception about whether they'd come forward about their symptoms. It's just something to think about. We've done it with diabetes, we've made huge changes, and we've done it with heart disease. I think it's only a matter of time, because the numbers and the current model is unsustainable in terms of costs.
Thanks. Can we go to you, Claire?
And just an observation, really, because even in this audience and certainly in this research, what also has come across is that there are people doing it extremely well. And unfortunately, the narrative of dementia care is the terrible stories. And really, we should be looking at the assets that we have within the system, and we should be actually saying, well, what are the key attributes? Why did that work? So that's one thing which our research hasn't been particularly good at doing. It's saying, oh, I think I know what will work, and let's go test it. And the other area is this issue about helping people to understand what good looks like. So taking Sheila's example, you know what good diabetic care looks like. You can make very informed judgments. Now, that's through your personal experience. But I think we also know what good cancer care looks like. We have a collective understanding that we should be seeing quickly, that certain things should happen, and so on and so forth. But we're not as clear about what good dementia care looks like, except we know it ought to be better. And I think that an assets-based approach that actually brings to the fore where integration has worked extremely well, where there are examples, and then looking to see how they can be translated and implemented into other places.
Do you have a last brief comment, Greg?
I think you're going to still have to look for the money in a few years' time.
Absolutely. Ray?
I find an interesting issue was raised on this of economics of it. Is the balance between healthcare and social care, which Martin and others have raised, I think very difficult and interesting issue. One, I know the colleagues, the PSSAU, tell us you've been looking at as to where the greatest marginal gain is, and would society be better off if we could transfer money in one way, one direction or the other, most likely from health to social care. A difficult question, partly I think because we don't perhaps have not had and maybe still don't have all the tools we need to answer this, to compare the outcomes from healthcare and social care in a way that we can address whether we'd be better off if X hundred million were moved across. So I think quite a challenging research and technical question there.
Very interesting, thank you. Martin, last quick comment.
My last quick comment is the fact that we're all here today discussing dementia is really positive, and we've all got to go away back to wherever we've come from and start raising this as an issue and moving towards a better system with better outcomes for people with dementia and their carers.
And last comment from you, Tom.
Certainly I'd like to thank everybody who's
who's attended and everybody who's spoken. A couple of observations, really. One is dementia is not just a UK issue, it's global, and some of Louise's data showed that very clearly. So we are not the only country in this. Indeed, other countries have got much more rapidly changing population structures than we do. And the second point for me, I think, is to sound a cautiously optimistic note. So although we have these challenges, we have these numbers, we have the money that we have or don't, but we nonetheless we have an issue that is publicly aired, that has political support and political will. We know a lot more than we did a few years ago about what works and what doesn't, what good care looks like and what bad care looks like. And so there are things that we can build on. So I wouldn't pretend that we've given you a lot of solutions. There are more gaps than there are solutions, but there's no reason not to be cautiously optimistic.
Thank you very much. And can I just end by saying that, it's not quite the end, because people are invited to have a drink and you can ask the panel a bit more there. But one thing that I didn't say was that with Alzheimer's Society Help, and that involves Clive, I chair an all-party group in Parliament on dementia, and we get an extraordinary amount of interest. And you know, it's the opposite of what used to happen. So a lot of MPs are now really interested. And when we did an inquiry into the benefits of early diagnosis, we got huge covering by interested MPs. So one thing, if we want to get this integrated care, one thing everybody could do is involve their MP, because now is the time, and I'm sure this is going to happen in Devon, but I think, because I know you'll make it happen, but it will happen in other parts of the country as well now, because the pressure locally is on their MP to get this right, and we all need to work together to get something to really move things along. And with the political clout from the Prime Minister right down, and everybody here involving their MP, it's a time to be, I think, optimistic about dementia care, and I hope research into dementia eventual cure. But in the meantime, thank you very much indeed. Thank you to the actuaries. Thank you to my colleagues from the ILC. Thank you to the technical helpers, particularly the one I know, and to all our speakers and to everyone who's taken part in what's a really interesting discussion. Thank you very much indeed.